Buenos días.
Good morning. Welcome all to the second edition of the initiative that we organized jointly with the Real Instituto Cano and the Naturgy Foundation. It intends to be an area for reflection on the geopolitical paths of energy transition. Last year, we talked specifically about the Middle East and the implications of the energy transition in this part of the world. And today we want to talk about the transatlantic relationship. And to open up this session, which we organized in a hybrid form with people here in person and over 800 people registered online, we have the great fortune of having with us Charles Powell, the director of Real Instituto Elcano, and Francisco Reynes, the president of Naturgy, who now has the floor. Good morning. Good morning, everyone, both to those here in person in our auditorium in Avenida de America, as well as everyone connected online. I believe it's an absolute pleasure for Naturgy to have these conferences as an area for reflection. And above all, because the quality of Instituto Elcano as a benchmark for geopolitical analysis and global analysis with a very rigorous intellectual perspective, it just confirms what we've been seeing lately, that energy has become the top priority in economic agendas, but also political agendas, and not just at a national level, but also worldwide. The fact that the sources of energy are located where they are, and we are not to blame for that. No one is responsible for that other than nature itself. And the fact that given the differences in geographical balances and geopolitical balances, geopolitical situations are very important when it comes to making these energy decisions or energy policy decisions. So it makes these meetings where we could reflect so important. And the Naturgy Foundation is promoting this with the initiative of the President Rafael Diaz-Seca, and the Real Instituto Elcano has taken on the challenge and complemented our interest with their expertise. In the two famous books on the power of nations, many of the things happening in the world today have to do with thousands of years ago and how natural resources have been managed by the various geopolitical balances. And I think now more than ever, this is absolutely so. I think today's discussion is particularly significant because, in fact, today's world of energy is facing two very different models. The American model, where with the very famous IRA, the main objective is to incentivize through tax policies, and not just tax policies, but to promote investment and, in the end, energy transition. And then we have the European model with all the various starting points that are so diverse from the various countries with regarding the dependence of the source of natural resources, and then the mixes of production and use of the various energy resources. That means that if anyone looked at us from afar, it seemed that it's reasonably organized. But then when you land, depending on the European country where you land, you'll see a lot of differences. And then in the short term, the approach we're seeing that everyone is over-regulating and with a very short-term perspective against incentivizing or deregulating compared to what they're doing in the United States. I think these are two very opposite models. We at Naturgy have always defended the private initiative of taking advantage of all those opportunities that could be available at the various stages.
Momento de la energía, especialmente.
And at this moment, with regard to energy, we want to promote a balance between the energy transition, what we've called the trilemma, the ability to guarantee supply while at the same time providing affordable prices for all of society. I think the challenge we're currently facing is to strike the balance between these three objectives. Sometimes we forget two of them and we focus only on one of them. But I think the fourth challenge, if I may, that is overarching all of this, is that all of this done with a perspective of incentivizing investments and, of course, within this incentive, having a return on the investment, and then finally to make sure that society can have short, medium, and long-term benefits from all of this. I think that's the purpose of today's conference. I would like to thank, in particular, the representatives of the Real Instituto Elcano for all the support they provide for these initiatives. And as I said at the beginning, all of you who are listening here in the room or online, I thank you for being here. Thank you very much. Good morning.
En nombre del Real Instituto Elcano.
On behalf of Real Instituto Elcano, I would like to thank the Foundation Naturgy, who's hosting us today, and express how very pleased and satisfied I am for the fact that we're holding these discussions. And I am certain that today it will be as interesting, if not more, than the ones we've held in the past. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Ms. Gonzalo Escribano, Mr. Steinberg, and Ms. Emily Benson, who's come from Washington to be with us this morning. Today is the Day of Europe, the 9th of May. It's St. Robert Schuman is some joke in Brussels. And therefore, it's an excellent day to reflect upon the European Union, upon its place in the world, and particularly about transatlantic relationships with the United States. Francisco has just mentioned a trilemma, and I would like to pose another one, the Charles Powell trilemma. It's not the one of Danny Roddick. I'm sure it doesn't have the same popularity or entity or hook. But the trilemma I'm referring to is the one that the European Union is currently facing, which obviously is made up of three challenges. The first one, what should our relationship be with the United States at a time of war in Europe, a war which obviously would end in just days if it weren't because of the military and financial support provided by the United States to our friends and allies in the Ukraine. Secondly, the big challenge of the rise of China. What should the European Union's policy be towards China? Ursula von der Leyen, the president of the Commission, said a month ago in Brussels at a meeting with various think tanks that we can't decouple ourselves from China, but we need to reduce the risk that this relationship with China currently entails. In other words, de-risking. And for me, the big challenge faced by the European Union is how to achieve this de-risking without getting to decoupling. We don't really understand how to do this or the financial cost of that. And the third challenge we face is the relationship of Europe without which we've called the Global South, which I don't really like. It reminds me of when the Russians call us the Collective West. As we keep talking about the Global South, they're going to believe they really are the Global South. And they're going to start acting as a bloc against us. And I think this is something we definitely don't want. But in any case, the relationship between Europe and emerging economies, economies that are not applying sanctions against Russia, such as India, South Africa, Pakistan, Israel, curiously enough, Mexico, these relationships are extremely important for all of us. Now, focusing briefly on the transatlantic relationship, I think what really defines this transatlantic relationship, which is very worrying for us, is the lack of balance. The increasingly asymmetrical balance existing between the United States and the European Union. So in summary, first of all, we're talking about an financial imbalance. In 2008, the European economy was larger in size than the American economy. Today, the U.S. economy is 50% larger than the European economy. We spent so much time attacking President Trump, and rightly so, by the way, that we forgot the fact that the financial gap between the European Union and the United States was getting larger in a very worrying manner. Secondly, the technology gap is widened. The five top tech companies in the United States completely dominate the European market. And in the Europe, we haven't been able to create European champions or adequately support our national champions. Thirdly, the military gap is increasing. The United States spend approximately $800 billion a year in defense. We spend a little bit more than before, a little bit more than $200 billion. But the United States spends seven times more than we do in leading-edge technologies related to defense. All of this can only lead to one conclusion: the gap. The financial gap, military and technological gap between the European Union and the United States is increasing. And this translates basically into a growing irrelevance of Europe in the eyes of the United States. By the way, there's been far more continuity between the Trump administration and the Biden administration than we would have expected. The prevailing philosophy in the United States is still America first, perhaps not America alone, but definitely America first. And this was made painfully manifest when the Inflation Reduction Act was passed. What's interesting about this process is the following. This was a discussion that took longer than a year and quite in the open. And at no time did the United States stop to think, how could this IRA affect Europe? The fact that they were injecting 376 billion euros into the American, or sorry, dollars into the American economy, which obviously would have a huge impact on our companies and in the world energy framework, was of absolutely no interest to the United States. The Canadians were far more alert and watchful. They were able to intervene in the process, and they achieved significant exemptions for their products and companies. The Europeans who knew this was happening, we did not intervene until it was too late. And I think this is something that we should probably be discussing today. The indifference of the United States regarding European interests and how we must react in the European Union regarding one of these dilemmas comprising Charles Powell's trilemma. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Charles and Francisco. You have certainly put on the table many different topics, and we definitely hope that the discussion will be very lively, that will allow us all to understand a little bit better what are the implications of the various positions that there are between the United States and Europe. And precisely in this context where, as Francisco Reynes and Charles were saying, there's a trilemma, the fight against climate change, the need to obtain competitive prices, affordable for everyone, and the security of supply. So that's the current context. So moving on to the agendas, you know, there are two different blocks. The first one is a lecture delivered by Emily Benson. I will be introducing her very shortly. And then the second part of today's meeting, there'll be a discussion with various panelists, both in person and some will be contacting remotely from Brussels. For this very first part, of the session. We have the great fortune of having with us Emily Benson. Emily is Director of Project and Trade and Technology and a Senior Fellow of the School in International Business, CSIS. She focuses on trade, investment, and technology, especially in this transatlantic context that we want to analyze today. Before joining CSIS, she managed transatlantic legislative relationships, transatlantic relationships. And her research has been published in New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Foreign Policy, and she's often cited in both national and international media. She has a degree in international relations and political science from the University of Colorado, and she has a master from the University of Geneva in Switzerland.
Today, and for coming from Washington yesterday, and for us, it's a real honor and pleasure having you here with us. So thank you very much, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you. And let me begin by thanking the hosts at Naturgy and also the partners at Alcano, especially my CSIS colleague, Federico Steinberg, who really did help put this together. It's an immense pleasure to be here. I am a big fan of the European Union. I've lived in and out of Europe throughout the last decade. And it's a particularly interesting time to be working at the nexus of energy security, trade, and transatlantic affairs. So thank you again for hosting, and thank you also to the staff. I know these events are much more energy intensive and stressful than they appear, so thank you to everyone for making this function so smoothly. I usually don't read remarks, but this is a hedge against being overly jet-lagged, so bear with me. What I would like to do is begin by providing an overview of the Biden administration's approach to trade relations. We're seeing a big shift occur, and I would like to begin by teasing out some of what that means. So the United States currently is pursuing what they are calling a non-traditional approach to trade policy. This could significantly reshape the contours of international trade rules as we know them. This new approach has manifested in the pursuit of many sectoral deals. This includes the forthcoming global arrangement on green steel and aluminum, and also smaller economic arrangements like the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, IPEF, or the US-EU Trade and Technology Council, the TTC. The main point of my remarks today will be to seek to answer a very simple question, which is, what does all of this mean? What is going on in Washington right now? How does it affect Spain? How does it affect the longer term trajectory of transatlantic relations? So I think to begin, there are two main bullet points that are important when contextualizing the administration's approach to trade, and these can be characterized by two main features. The first is the urgency of combating the climate emergency. The second is a growing injection of national security concerns into what traditionally were economic considerations. And again, these are both kind of contained in the global arrangement on sustainable steel and aluminum. This is the creative workaround where the European Union is seeking a TRQ system to get rid of the Trump administration tariffs, and then in so doing also incentivize the adoption and facilitate the additional trade of green commodities like steel and aluminum. For the Americans, however, this is primarily a mechanism for levying tariffs on Chinese overcapacity of commodities. So we already see a little bit different of alignment in this one arrangement, where for the Americans, it's China, for the Europeans, it's trade, it's decarbonization. Whether or not we can shoehorn that into one common direction and actually kill three birds with one stone remains to be seen, but I think it's important that we remember there sometimes are divergent objectives. So let me also go into next the Inflation Reduction Act. I appreciate the comments, and I also have reservations about it. After I do an overview of my perspective and the kind of the American take on the IRA, I will go into a couple of highlights of where I see the approach in Brussels overlapping with the American approach, and then also tease out a little bit of where they diverge and what we can learn from that. So the IRA, as we all know, was signed into law in August of last year. It primarily aims to reduce carbon emissions through investments in domestic manufacturing, procurement of critical mineral supplies, and it also aims to boost research and development in leading green technologies. It is the largest single climate spend in history, as I understand it. It gets almost to the $370 billion price tag. And along with the big infrastructure package and the chips and science, the big semiconductor package that passed, together this will inject a little over $800 billion in the American economy. That boils down to about $80 billion a year over the next decade, just on climate spending. So this is bridges, solar, EV tax credit, it's all of it together, but it's being done through three different legislative mechanisms. And we tend to think of this only in the context of the IRA, but if you take the other packages, it's actually a much more significant overhaul of the American infrastructure and domestic green economy as we know it. The IRA is a combination of grants, tax incentives, and loan guarantees. For example, about $96 billion will boost renewable energy resources. This particularly will strengthen hydrogen, solar, and wind. I think this is another thing that we tend to overlook in the IRA is that we think IRA, EV tax credit. There is actually $13 billion in tax credits going to hydrogen alone. So there's sort of a risk that we over-inject cash into hydrogen, causing it to significantly reduce in price over time. So if I were European, I would have the hydrogen economy on my mind for the next couple of years. The measures most relevant to the IRA and international impact of the IRA are its energy and climate subsidies. These fall into three categories of their own. One, obviously, is subsidies for vehicle purchases, including the $7,500 tax credit. It also includes production and investment subsidies for manufacturers of clean tech products, think batteries. The third is subsidies for producers of carbon neutral electricity, hydrogen, and other clean fuels. There are a host of kind of bonus top-up credits, again, for hydrogen or for wind and solar, where if you use American-made steel, you can qualify for extra credits. So they're kind of stacked throughout this big package. But we don't really know yet who will be the big winners. Again, there's been outsized focus on the EV tax credit so far. I think once the dust settles and we get additional guidance on the EV tax credit, the discussion will probably shift. But it's very slow. The IRA is being implemented by several US government agencies. Guidance is trickling out, and so it's still, even though it was passed last year, still difficult to see exactly who will be the big beneficiaries. However, the IRA's impact on transatlantic trade, as you all know here, has been very significant. One of the main distinguishing factors, of course, with our legislation and for foreign partners is the reliance on domestic incentives. This contrasts quite clearly with the European approach, which now is relaxing state aid, but also has a stronger set of regulatory functions. So a stick and carrot, and the United States is still relying overwhelmingly on carrots. In addition to the local content requirements, another big theme of the IRA is its focus on China. And I think this is another major distinguishing factor with the European approach to climate change is that for the Americans, this is fundamentally a climate package against China. So if you look at the EV tax credit, it defines countries of concern, which is problematic because then you have to define who is a country of concern. But in this case, it broadly means China, Russia, North Korea, and Venezuela kind of comes on and off the list in the United States. I don't think that there is a clear attempt in Congress to hoover up jobs from Europe at a geopolitically precarious time. I think various elements of the tax credit were basically an accident. Senator Joe Manchin made remarks at Davos where he said, well, I wasn't really aware that we didn't have a free trade agreement with the European Union. And I believe that. It's appalling. One of my colleagues said that it was shocking incompetence by a United States sitting senator. And that's exactly what it was. But unfortunately, I think a very simple answer is that a lot of the people on the Hill did not realize the effects that this would have on a lot of our partners, namely the European Union and the Republic of Korea. So overall, I think it's primarily a green jobs package, but also a China package, and there's unfortunate collateral damage that they failed to take into account. So this all leads to another question that's on everyone's mind, which is, will the European Union get one of these EV critical mineral bilateral deals with the United States? I think one of the more interesting facets there is whether or not the administration can actually pursue deals that would satisfy the requirements of the Inflation Reduction Act. They failed to get this authority from Congress to go out and negotiate quote unquote real trade deals. And so their hands are really tied in what they're able to achieve. So they could go out and do kind of a small deal that didn't have real impact. It wasn't legal in nature. They wouldn't have to seek congressional consent for that. But in order to fulfill the actual language of the bill, they'll probably have to submit it back through Congress, which could open up a hot political debate as election season kicks off in the United States. So the story there is the longer we wait, the harder it becomes for Brussels and Washington to get this bilateral deal through. Either way, I think that we tend to think the IRA will automatically succeed and that it will necessarily harm EU industry. I'm less convinced about that because it's depending on a lot going right. There was one study that came out that's been widely cited by the Rhodium Group that suggests the IRA will result in a 40% reduction in emissions in the United States by 2030. But again, this assumes everything is deployed smoothly, there are no hiccups, that state governments are on board, that Republicans do not try to overturn various facets of the IRA. And in parallel to the deployment of funds, we see a very heated debate happening about permitting reform. And this is the idea that we won't be able to really scale up sufficiently and quickly enough without redoing some of our permitting laws. That has stalled in Congress for a host of reasons, but we see a very odd grouping of senators, some from the far left in the United States and far right, ecologists from Hawaii, for example, coming together with the natural gas people of Louisiana to say we need permitting reform now in order to make the IRA a reality. So sometimes when we think, oh my gosh, hoovering up EU jobs, the reality might be a little bit more constrained than that, and so I think that's something that's worth keeping in mind. So what does this all mean in the transatlantic context? Despite key differences in their approaches to trade and climate, the United States and European Union share several commonalities in their approaches to trade. I think first and foremost, as was alluded to earlier, they both strongly believe in de-risking versus decoupling. President von der Leyen outlined this in a recent speech on China. And while the US may aim for strategic decoupling in a targeted set of national security critical sectors like chips, both the EU and US are inherently aligned in the belief that total decoupling is not possible. It's not politically possible either. They both also fundamentally believe in the power of incentives. The European Union recently committed its own $270 billion package to combat climate change as part of the recovery fund. And this compares again to the $369 billion in the United States. So while we do see a misalignment on the spending packages overall, they're not that different. Second, there is broad alignment among private sector actors on both sides of the Atlantic when it comes to doing business with China. So rhetorically, we see the temperature turning up with the US government and Chinese government, but companies still want to do business. And in one kind of bite-sized tweet, what I would say is that the attitude, the prevailing sense among the US private sector entities is everyone wants to do business, but no one wants to testify. Companies do not want to put their CEOs in a situation of having to defend doing business in China. What this means is that less CEOs, less private sector representatives are going to Congress and trying to persuade their representatives to take trade-friendly stances. What that means is that the quality of policy, particularly on trade, emanating from the legislative branch is reduced. So it's really had a chilling effect on what the private sector is able to do in terms of trade policy persuasion. I think the hawkishness on China is unlikely to change given a change in administration, but it will still be important for the private sector to do what it can to persuade the government to keep trade relations open. Another commonality between the United States and European Union, and one that is made potentially worse by the inability of the US to pursue trade deals, is that for both the EU and US, costs are likely to rise and efficiencies will decrease as governments and the private sector seek to friendshore and reshuffle supply chains. Secretary Yellen, our Treasury Secretary, has recently made a major speech about this where she essentially said national security comes first and it likely will come with costs, but we are committing to this new vision of friendshoring. I think what remains to be seen is to what degree industrial policies in the EU and US will succeed in offsetting some of these costs that will come with friendshoring, and whether or not we can sufficiently grow the transatlantic economy that would really get those costs down to a marginal amount. Another shared concern for the EU and US is the continued threat of economic coercion by China, particularly the threat to curb exports on minerals and other vital inputs to the green transition. As resources become increasingly scarce, countries may turn increasingly protectionist. I think, again, a total retraction of the global economy isn't possible, but a profound reshuffle is already underway. A turn towards protectionism, whether it's the Americans, the Europeans, third countries, China, a turn towards protectionism could exacerbate fragmentation and it could lead to more consistent supply chain disruptions. This could potentially affect a broad panoply of our economy, ranging from solar panels and electric vehicles to everyday medications. It will thus fall on allied economies to ensure that they have contingency plans, particularly in the case of a black swan event in Taiwan, to really make sure that we have the supplies that we will need to continue the green transition. Energy security represents a key area where trade fragmentation and protectionism could have particularly adverse effects. The kind of price shocks and power supply cuts we're seeing today could scale up more frequently with more frequent disruptions. So coordination becomes even more important than it has been recently. So I think we're facing overall a similar geopolitical threat environment in which cooperation becomes even more important. Despite these commonalities, there are of course very persistent differences in the transatlantic approaches to the climate we're seeing now, climate in both senses. The European Union and United States continue to pursue very different approaches to the intersection of international trade and climate change mitigation. Again, the United States is pursuing these smaller sectoral arrangements, while the European Union continues to affirm its support for the global multilateral trading system. We were discussing last night that one key difference is the US says, well, in certain cases, the multilateral trading rules have really benefited us. Therefore, we can come on board at some points. Whereas the European Union has this inherent belief in that multilateralism is good and worth fighting for. And that, again, will, I think, show itself in the ensuing talks about WTO reform. There are also major differences between the European and American approaches to geopolitics. This manifests, again, particularly strongly with how each party sees China as a problem and to what degree. In the United States, there's this growing sense that China is no longer our biggest customer, but it's our biggest threat. This is based on the assumption that Chinese economic power is a direct threat to the United States. I think we can have a separate debate on that, whether or not that's true, but that is a prevailing sentiment. In the European Union, things are quite different because countries like Germany continue to view China as a key export market, particularly for consumer goods like automobiles. The formation of a new US-China committee in Congress highlights this growing consensus that we need to act fast on China. And again, this is going to remain a very persistent and potentially complicated political period, I think, both for the United States and from our allies. This view on China, of course, differs very starkly from the European Union. Von der Leyen, however, is signaling that the European Union may be coming closer and closer towards the US approach to China. She recently confirmed, for example, the abandonment of the Comprehensive Agreement on Investment, which everyone suspected, but she has now said outright. So it's possible that we will get a new chapter in transatlantic relations when it comes to China, but it's a little bit early to tell. The second major distinction in US-EU approaches to trade is whether or not economic security is a matter of national security. The United States has recently pursued a set of trade objectives, whether it's in the IRA or the Chips and Science Act, that are explicitly aimed at encouraging countries and companies to reshuffle supply chains away from China. I think one thing that's interesting here is the CHIPS agreement that came out of the October 7th export controls. These were originally unilateral. The Dutch have since signed on and so have the Japanese, but it took way longer than the Americans anticipated to convince others to come on board. So I think that denotes an ongoing skepticism about the US approach to China. Allies weren't quite there yet, and they had to receive added incentives to really join this new approach. This all leads to another difference in transatlantic approaches to trade, which is friendshoring, the other hot term. If you look at early speeches from Yellen 2 summers ago, this term actually started out as ally shoring, which is maybe a worse trade term. But ally shoring invited a whole host of questions about who's an ally. Is this only a NATO ally? Does it denote some sort of military engagement or relationship? And the term hence changed to friendshoring. As I alluded to earlier, this causes a second set of issues, which is defining who's a friend. But I think right now, the general understanding and definition of friendshoring is deeper economic engagement with a country we do not perceive to be a threat. So this includes Indonesia, for example, who is not necessarily aligned, but also not necessarily a threat. The friendshoring approach is manifested in the administration shying away from traditional trade deals. They have eschewed market access and tariff reductions for alternative economic arrangements. So this is a massive departure in the way the Americans have gone about trade for the last several decades. What's even more interesting is that allies continue to tell the administration, please engage in tariff negotiations. We want real trade. They hear it constantly, especially in the Indo-Pacific economic framework, where countries like Indonesia or Vietnam really want us to get back to the real deal. Despite these persistent reminders, it seems unlikely, at least in the short term. This contrasts with the European Union, which continues to pursue very robust FTAs. It's also taking a hard law approach when it comes to the carbon border adjustment mechanism, which will, I guess, officially launch with reporting requirements in October. Another difference in the transatlantic relationship is about the durability of policies that are promulgated. And I think this is something very important to remember from a member state perspective and then also at the European Union level. In the United States, there are already efforts underway, as I mentioned, to overturn various facets of the Inflation Reduction Act. This is part of the negotiation to raise the debt ceiling limit. And so Republicans are saying, well, if you don't negotiate here, we'll undo parts of the IRA. This highlights, again, the very rocky state of US domestic politics right now. And the way that policy functions in the US is sort of on a 2.5-year cycle. You know, you get into office and then the election clock starts ticking all over again. We all have elections. I think we're all susceptible to the winds of politics at some time. But in the US, it really cannot be overstated that every 4 years we face this inevitable truth of undoing everything from the past 4 years. And although there are certainly lots of commonalities between the Trump and Biden approaches to trade, We wouldn't have a climate package were it not for the Biden administration. We wouldn't have anything like this. We would have a completely different reality when it comes to the future of energy markets. So I think that's a big thing that's worth keeping in mind. So at the beginning, and sorry to have droned on for so long, I said I would try to answer what this all means in the transatlantic context. So we haven't really had a formal doctrine of where the administration is headed. We don't have these white papers that come out of the European Union that say, here's our digital decade, here's what we'll be doing in 5 or 10 years. It really is sort of an ad hoc approach to governance where you have competing constituencies, different agencies want different things. Janet Yellen wants to be softer on China. The Commerce Department wants to be a little bit harder. So where does it all go from here? Our national security advisor, Jake Sullivan, provided remarks a couple of weeks ago that were really the best articulation that we've had to date on the overall grand strategy, on where it's all headed. And basically, at its very core, Sullivan said for the first time, they are fundamentally reshaping capitalism. Capitalism needs to look different. He also said that international trade was based on a set of quote-unquote oversimplified assumptions. For the chief advisor to the US president, this is a massive shift in the way the Americans are going about global economic governance. In one of my favorite metaphors from this speech, he said that we're moving away from a Parthenon style of economic governance, you know, clear columns, clear lines, you know what you're getting, towards a Frank Gehry style of international economic architecture. And I know Gehry has several very cool buildings here in Spain, but it's these very messy contours of steel and aluminum. And I think in some ways that does reflect a more realistic reality of how the global economy really works. And it's kind of a happy coincidence actually, but Frank Gehry has a new museum that's opening in Abu Dhabi in 2025. And his artistic vision for this museum was literally intentionally messy, moving into clarity. And it's a lucky coincidence that the Sullivan speech kind of called that out a little bit, where he's basically saying, bear with us, we're doing a whole rethink of the economic system, but it will bear fruit, it will work. I think what this means overall is that the American administration at the moment is calling on its allies for patience and confidence in building a global vision. Sullivan actually said that this will require dedicated commitment from partners. And he also, throughout his speech, called out von der Leyen's de-risking approach. So he really was providing a lot of support, at least rhetorically, for the European Union. Overall, what this means is that the message is to trust Americans and the rest will come. This relies on a fundamental assumption that the administration has time to finish the job, to actually conclude it and get the job done. This may not be the case with the impending election. And with a ticking clock, it's unclear that we'll even get a critical minerals deal done. I mean, the timeline is very, very short. I think it's also asking a lot of our partners to say, just trust us. We've never made any foreign policy missteps in the past. Just come on board. And so there are a lot of assumptions embedded in here that countries are willing to take tremendous geopolitical risk, incur economic costs, and potentially lose economic efficiencies to which we've become very accustomed throughout the past couple of decades. Overall, it's clear that allied economies around the world do have to contend with this new multipolar reality. Our Secretary of State, Antony Blinken, said at a speech in October that the post-Cold War world is over. We are clearly entering a new chapter of history. What this means for trade and energy security is not yet clear, but I believe that with new alliances emerge new opportunities. It's very easy to be doomsday and pessimistic about all these economic changes, but it's also a new chapter. We can build something new if we so desire. Emerging technologies, energy security, green supply chains, a fundamental de-risking also doesn't need to mean less trade. It can mean more trade, but trade will look different. So for EU member states like Spain, this presents, I think, an opportunity to deepen ties, forge new alliances, and help integrate resiliency and energy security into global economic architecture. There's a really big role to play. Things may look messy Olaf, and Gary for now, but together we can bring about a new clarity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Emily. It's a really interesting lecture with your vision about this situation, though this seems not to be easy. You know? We are talking about trade, energy, materials, China, Taiwan, and a lot of things to do also with, around the IRA. Vamos a pasar a la segunda parte de la sesión.
Let's now begin the second part of our session, where we're going to hold a debate and discussion between different participants, all of them real experts on the subject. We have, first of all, Federico Steinberg. He is the main researcher of Elcano Institute and also a researcher in the program Europe, Russia, and Eurasia of the International Center for International Studies. He has also arrived last night from Washington to be with us. We also have a special advisor for security, Josep Borrell. Federico has a PhD and he also has a Master's in International Relations by Columbia University, consultant of the World Bank. He also worked at UN, and he's very well known in the national and international media. He's an expert in finance, and I think he's excellent to join these two worlds. We also have with us from Brussels, Carlos Maraval. He works at the European Commission. He's coordinator of the Recovery and Resilience Plans for Spain within the Energy DG. He has a degree by New York University and another one from Carlos III University. He worked in Financial Stability DG. Then he was also in Economic and Financial Affairs Department, and now he is in the Energy Department. Before that, he worked in the public administration in Spain, also in the Instituto de Empresa and Carlos III University, and he also as a financial consultant. We also have with us from Brussels, Claudia Yáñez, who is responsible for policies at the Energy DG, where she has been working since 2020. She has a degree in law, political science by Barcelona University, and she's working on her PhD. She is focusing right now in the coordination team, competencies, fair transition policies, and monitoring of the implementation of EU Repower. Before that, she worked in other institutions. And finally, we have with us Marta Blanco Quesada, current chairman of the International COE. And she has a degree in business administration by Autonomous University in Madrid. She has an MBA by the Escuela de Organización Industrial. And she also participated in many negotiations with the World Trade Organization. And she has held several public functions, and she worked in the ISICS, for example. They're here to talk about the market, about energy, energy transition, and this fantastic panel must be chaired by another great expert like Gonzalo Estribano. He works at the Instituto Elcano. He has done lots of research work, geoeconomy, geopolitics, and he's well known by everyone when we try to understand the complexity of this world we live in. Nobody better, I think, to chair this session. So if you have any questions, you can send them For those of you who are connected online, you can send your questions online. And for those of you who are in the room, you have some cards that you can use to write down your questions. So thank you to all the participants for being here. And thank you to the people who are in Brussels who are going to participate. And without any further ado, Gonzalo, you have the floor. Thank you. Thank you to the foundation and all the people who are here. I think we're going to start to look with panels with less qualified people because the CVs take about 15 minutes if we cover every single aspect. So let's get down to the point. First of all, I'd like to begin by thanking Emily. I think she's given us a different vision than we usually have here. Very comprehensive, touching upon many subjects and talking about the climate, which is something that the great admirers of the IRA in Europe usually overlook. And I think it is very relevant, the climate dimension. So very quickly, let's start with Federico. We had also invited our friends from the U.S. Embassy, but they had other commitments and couldn't attend. We're very sorry for that. But Emily, I think, did an excellent job also on behalf of the embassy. So, Federico, you have a privileged view. You know the U.S. very well for many reasons. You spend a lot of time there. Tell us, please, what is that crossed vision that you would like to share with our audience? Yes, thank you very much. Very briefly, in 5 minutes, just 3 points, 3 bullets that have to do with what Emily explained. In other words, where is the thinking right now in terms of economics and the security and the crossword between geopolitics and the economy, which is much stronger right now in the U.S., and it can be defined basically in going back to neoprotectionism and an obsession with building things in the U.S., physical things, I mean, that will create quality jobs and better paid jobs and will strike a balance. Because, of course, the globalization has not worked as they thought they would, and that will make them more resilient vis-a-vis the shocks that are coming, which might be similar to pandemics, military conflicts. That is a philosophy. Second point, Europe, what can we do? And thirdly, do companies stand in all of this? Well, I think Emily explained it in a very sophisticated way, but I will put it in very simple terms. I think that in the history of pendular movements of the world economy, where we see very open periods and periods that are more closed, when we look at history in 2050, we will call this period a neoprotectionist period, a period where the leadership of the U.S. in maintaining liberal world order open and supported in multilateral institutions is coming to an end. I'm not saying it has already ended. The vision is that if it doesn't hurt, some plurality agreements can be supported, but that is not the priority, as Emily said. We don't expect the U.S. to sign any free trade agreement in the next few years, many years, with the exception of bilateral agreement with Taiwan, which would be all focused on geopolitics and very little on the economy. And the Taiwanese don't want it, really, because it would make China more nervous still. And a way of rebalancing the economy, because we see the U.S. from outside as very strong, and the figures that Charles gave were spectacular. The U.S. economy as a G7 was 40% of the G7, and now it's 55. It is true that they've had a very dynamic economy. The technological revolution has given them an important push, but that does not mean that internal polarization is not brutal. And that has as an origin identity movements of cultural wars, but also elements of economic inequalities, which Trump in his way and Biden in his way, well, there is a consensus that must be rebalanced. And it is rebalanced with industrial policy and the American foreign policy for the middle class, which is what Jake Sullivan described, that also Emily mentioned, which is better jobs for Americans. And if that is protectionist, well, so it may be. So this is something that we live with anxiety because Europeans value cooperation in itself and not because it has good outcomes for our companies and citizens, but because we've built a narrative, which is true, which is that Europe came out of the 20th century successful thanks to multilateral cooperation, and that has a value in itself, more than economic interests that it may protect. So we feel uncomfortable with this decline of multilateralism, and we see ourselves, as always happens, with this more mercantilistic vision that starts in the U.S., but it comes to Europe with a mixture because we have more state, welfare state in Europe, more public intervention. That is a direction of the U.S. Economy, but on the other hand, our pockets are less deep, and therefore we cannot give the same subsidies that the Americans give, especially if we don't behave as a fiscal union, not to speak of a political union. And the EU is in a situation where some countries have more funds to support their companies, others less. The framework of state aid must be protected. The internal market must be protected. That is the jewel of the crown. And that is what we need to use if we want to have more muscle, especially for digital matters where we're lagging behind. We're not lagging behind in climate, but in digital we are. And the debates on GPT-4, I think, established this very clearly. Europe regulates but does not innovate. It doesn't know how to monetize innovations. But at the Elcano Institute, we're working on what the EU must do in its economic model to provide a response. And everything leads us to a fiscal union. And if we want to do this properly, we would have to modify the treaties. And we don't know if we want to go into that. But in a situation of war in Europe, the IRA in the US, the need to rethink the economic policies. If we don't do it now, then when? And some things are changing. We know that the EU has always reacted with more integration when it faces a crisis and when it has external enemies or pressures. And this is the moment we're in. So what about companies? What is happening is that there are a lot of amounts of money available on both sides of the Atlantic of aid, lots of aid for many sectors, but especially sectors related to energy transition. But when you're in seminars, the Americans say, we have to do everything, renewables, but we also need gas and oil because there's a huge demand and we won't be able to meet it. So there's a bid for everything with the idea that the political economy should change. The IRA wants to invest a lot on Republican states so that for 10 years there will be lots of subsidies. And those who don't believe very much in climate change will believe that it's a good idea to make investments in the fight against climate change because that will generate jobs and dynamism. So for European companies that want to work in the United States, there are lots of opportunities. We should take advantage of that. And on the European side, some of the things we will be able to match. That pessimism and the EU is not very relevant. They don't think a lot about the EU in the States because we're an ally and we're not a concern. But sometimes we have to raise our hand and say, well, there are some things where we want transatlantic relations to be better balanced. I'm going to leave it there. Thank you. Thank you, Federico. Carlos, I hope that you can hear us well. Can you hear me? Yes, we can. Could you raise the volume a bit? Thank you. Carlos, Federico's question was very clear. In the and the this crisis we're going to respond. I'm sure that at the Commission, your view is much more long-term, but I'm going to let you answer the question posed by Federico. And thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go back to the distance between the United States and Europe. At least I'm perceiving there are certain differences in the positions in Belgium, Brussels, and Madrid. I don't know if Claudia will say the same, but to summarize, we have addressed the biggest geopolitical challenge of the EU. Our biggest energy supplier has cut the supply and created a war practice. And there are times in Spain, like the crisis in Northern Europe, when thinking about South Europe, you're in a luxury position when it comes to thinking about supply security. In the north of Brussels, we're still thinking about this. Going back to what you were saying about the balance, I think there are many problems that are global, but many of them are also local. And here in Europe, we've had to face that challenge. And perhaps, just to give you a small example to illustrate to what extent the situation has been precarious, so to speak, we had infrastructures for liquefying gas within the European pipelines that were completely obsolete. And we've had to resort to bringing gas that was stored in the UK and then sent through the pipelines under the Strait to make sure that the light carried on and that we still had heating last year. Obviously, we've come out of that. From the DG, we're not want to say that this is the absolute truth. But when you go back to our main providers, what we need to point out, if we think about the challenges for the EU, instead of inviting someone from the United States, we should have invited someone from Norway, because right now our main gas provider is Norway, not the United States. I'm saying all this so that we could focus on European problems. And the ones that are being considered globally are very relevant, but we've lived a very extreme situation in Europe, and we've managed to overcome it. I'm a public officer, obviously, and we're subject to being attacked and being told we're not doing things properly. But I just want to remind you that neither gas nor electricity nor heating was ever cut off in any member state in all these places. Other countries, such as Australia, have had power cuts. And California, which is the mecca of everything, has suffered power cuts here. That's never happened in Europe, and not just in a context where Russia was constantly threatening us and generating this war, but the main provider of electricity in Europe was traditionally France, has had huge problems as far as supply. So maintaining everything on throughout the winter, I think, in Spain, because it's been warm and we go having tapas out in the park, outdoor, it all sounds very far away. But there was a paper sent about the reform of the electricity market, and nothing referred to the supply security, very little. They were just referring to lowering prices in Europe, in the Northern Europe, in Brussels. It wasn't a matter of price. It was just a matter of making sure there were no cuts. And Russia has played with this very actively. We can't be naive and pretend it wasn't the case, but it was very clear what their objective was. So let's focus, if you like, or at least in Brussels, we need to focus, because that's what they pay us for, on maintaining the lights on and the heating on. And for this, we've had to resort to intervention measures. And it's not my opinion. Other think tanks are saying it. They were really extreme. We've, you know, rolled up our sleeves to be present in the market with a very close monitoring of all this. And this has put us in situations where companies on a daily basis were in a very tight spot because we've said to the member states, you have to do this, this, that, and the other, and now it's a long list. In the modern world, it's all an Excel spreadsheet, and if you don't tick all the boxes, then we justify why life is not going well for them. They didn't commit, et cetera. But this year, our actions were very different. In fact, we've had to ask member states not to do things because at times, maybe you don't do enough, which is what traditionally happens, according to the Commission, but sometimes you do too much. And those extreme intervention measures, which I measured is one of the market correction mechanism, where basically we said we're not going to allow an upward bids in the price of gas in European markets, because if we go into total panic with everything related to risk or not having enough capacity, or now it's raw materials, solar panels, etc. Last August, it was gas, and we were bidding above the international market, and there was a member state, Germany, that was fixing prices, and we were seeing market distortions even within Europe. There were price hikes in the gas of the word TTF, the reference for Central Europe, and France, Spain, and so on. So being at the market level, as we've had to be in the past year, it's something that's not usual. I personally don't want to talk on behalf of the Commission. I don't feel comfortable with it. But sometimes you just have to roll up your sleeves and get on with it. And at the same time, it was possible basically because the public administrations have worked together with households and companies to make this possible. And in this regard, we've done it because, and I'm going to be here defending our work, it's because we're far more present in the lives of citizens than they are in the United States, for several reasons. And I think the main one is the United States has natural resources that don't exist in Europe. So if we want to continue living with our standard of living, even if we don't have gas or the current supply of gas is dying out, we practically have no oil. So we have to resort to other third-party states that are also external, such as the UK and Norway. We systematically need to be coordinating among ourselves and reaching agreements. So we have far more limitations than a state that has natural resources like the United States, which forces us to adopt these recovery plans, where we can't limit ourselves to just thinking about specific investments for specific things, but we need to think as a joint society to live in a world where fossil fuels are going to be far less present in our lives because we've lost our main provider. And the recovery plans in this regard, I think comparing them to the American ones is not very clear because they have far more there are more measures to have allowed us to survive this year. For example, public transport that has electricity generated with mills or solar panels. We have renewable energies that are far more present in Europe than they are in the United States. And going back to what Emily mentioned, which I think is very relevant, and the boost of the United States with this IRA, Inflation Reduction Act, the United States had a lot of catching up to do, and they still have a lot of catching up to do with Europe and China. So in this regard, as far as monetary and incentives at the moment that could leave us behind. Yes, that's true. But the big benchmark as far as renewable installations is China, not the United States. The country that is promoting EVs is China, not the United States, no matter how much we look at Tesla. And that's what I would look at, these topics that are EU issues that we need to address. And this year, I would say we've addressed the biggest challenge we've ever faced, because if we'd had a power cut and we hadn't had heating in countries such as Germany and so on, perhaps the current situation vis-a-vis Ukraine would be very different. It's very clear, Carlos. Thank you very much. And I will keep that idea that IRA are the resilience and recovery plans that are not just addressing a financial transition crisis, but also geopolitical crisis. And I I think this is a very significant topic. I would ask Claudia. Claudia, I hope you can hear me well. The question is, are we prepared for that energy transition, those resilience and recovery plans and funds? Do we have the necessary skills? How do you think we're working in Europe in this area? Thank you very much, Gonzalo. Well, adding on to what my colleague Carlo has said, we last year focused on repower. We were living in a situation that the United States has not experienced. In the north of Europe, was focusing more on national security, making sure that there were no power cuts, that all the basic services could be provided to all European citizens. And that was what repowering was all about. So our response, so to speak, to the IRA was a combination of follow-up of Repower EU, because the Net Industry Act and the Green Deal Industrial Plan are based on the Repower EU objectives and the Green European Pact that was announced by the President von der Leyen. And our objectives with the Repower EU is increase energy efficiency, increase development of clean energies, and diversify supply. So in this case, we're focusing on energy supplying, but now we're thinking about the supply of critical raw materials. And this is due to the fact that the map and context in Europe is very different. It's European. So as Carlos so well said, we need to focus on what we have at home, because if we don't work on a domestic perspective, we're not going to be able to address what's going on in the rest of the world in such a changing political environment and multipolar, as Federico has pointed out, and also Emily has described. So we're in a situation where global markets in net zero technologies are going to be tripled by 2030. It's a very attractive market niche for the Europe and the global industry. We're in a situation where we have not just energy dependence on gas, but this dependence was reduced in Russia by almost 47% compared to 2021. But even so, as Carlos has pointed out, we depend on other partners, such as in this case, Norway, the United States, with liquefied natural gas. And we're also in need for investments. For 2030, it is estimated that we'll need 22 billion euros in supply chains in the European for these net zero technologies. And then we have different barriers. We need supply chains that are secure, where our dependencies are very large. We need price stability. See, because we have these market dependencies, we're exposed to price shocks. And also our long lead times. So when we need, for example, a battery for EVs, the lead times could be even 5 years long. So we really need to accelerate all of this. And here is my main point of intervention, which are skills. It's also one of the main barriers. It's a global barrier. It's not just happening in Europe. It's something that everybody's talking about. Everybody is seeing this. And last week, some colleagues sent me a video from the Secretary of Energy of the United States, Jennifer Granholm, who was calling in almost a bellicose term for workers and citizens of the United States to join public administrations because they need the skills to implement the IRA. Basically, we have the same situation. We need people with the necessary skills qualified to implement all these measures so that all the money that we have in various funds, so that all this regulation can be implemented. And in this case, we find that there are shortages of labor. Citizens and workers are not qualified enough to achieve all the objectives that we have set. So in this net zero Regulation is already talking about this creation of these net zero skilled academies based on projects that are already being implemented, such as the Academy for Batteries. And we're developing cybersecurity, the European powerhouse. We're going to focus very much on hydrogen, also in heat pumps and other things like that. But it's something we're already working on and we're already focusing on. The problem is there are many challenges. One of them are data. What are the needs? We have estimates from the industry, but we need estimates from the public sector. For example, in Germany, they are conducting estimates, not just in the energy sector, but also global estimates of the needs of the labor market. What do we need to meet the need for workers? I think the EU is focusing very much, and it's something that we're constantly talking about with stakeholders and industry representatives and public administrations. We're always talking about, and to close my intervention, I don't want to use up too much time, going back to resilience and recovery plans, RRPs, we have national plans for energy and climate. And their update of their draft will be submitted to the member states on the 30th of June. And the final updated plans have to be delivered in 30th of June of 2024. And they particularly focus on competitiveness. It's one of the five dimensions of this energy initiative. And the NZA, the Net Zero Energy Act, also talks about this. It's a tool for strategic planning, which is how we work in Europe, with strategic planning looking to the medium and long term, but also paying attention to the short term when it's necessary and urgent. So I think it's a very good opportunity, not so much for financing, because the plans are for strategic planning, but rather to look towards the future. What are the needs? What do we need to focus on? How can we diversify the supply chains, and how can we prepare our workers and public administrations and also citizens and young people who are studying at the moment and need to train to implement this energy transition. And that would be my initial words. Thank you very much, Claudia. We're now, after this view of DG Energy, we're going to talk a little bit about how companies see this. So, Marta, how do you think the European Union should respond or should have responded to this crisis that we've experienced with Ukraine? How do you see the IRA from companies? I suppose you see the glass half full of opportunities, but I'm sure some of your colleagues will have seen it, how full of protectionism, as Federico said. But it's, when we were talking yesterday, you said perhaps, and our American friends might not like to hear that, but there may be lessons learned from this, what's happening in the United States, even though we have our own models. So what elements could we include in the European Union? From the business sector, how do you see this discussion? Thank you very much, Gonzalo. The truth is, listening to all the various speakers, I think we all have the huge advantage of participating at this event to organize our ideas a little bit about a topic that is so very complex and it could be addressed from so many different angles. So we've all made this exercise of organizing where we are at and where we want to be. And your questions are going in that direction. So the companies, where were we coming from? Where are we in? Where do we want to go? It's a truly uncertain environment at the moment. So we've talked about where we were coming from in a situation that was tremendous, with a war in Europe, with the need to urgent need to diversify the sources of energy in the European countries. Carlos mentioned Norway. It's true that it's a significant supplier, but when you analyze the data in Spain, in the case of gas coming from the United States, imports in Spain have gone from 2,500 billion to over 10 billion in 2022. So that's the first direct impact that we're seeing. And we were coming from a situation where we had to diversify, and that's where we companies are heading towards with huge energy costs. We, at the end of the day, want to be competitive, and energy costs are taking competitiveness away from us compared to other companies from other countries. And this was a situation that we already had in the past that we needed to address. So we addressed this with the war, and where is the current situation? I like what Charles said, and I agree with him. We were looking at that discussion about what was brewing in the United States, but we weren't paying a lot of attention to it. And then suddenly it hit us, and it hit us practically overnight, this Inflation Reduction Act. Yesterday, we were saying the first time I had alarms sounding off, it wasn't in Spain, in the United States, or the European Union. It was in Korea, a trip to Korea, where my Korean colleagues started talking about this initiative. We in Europe were still not analyzing the impact that it was going to have. And when we started looking at it, we focused very much on analyzing what was happening with the IRA, how it was going to affect European companies. But what I really like what has been mentioned earlier regarding, and in this case, I agree with the Commission, I must say, it's true that this has meant that we've had to have an internal discussion among ourselves about this so-called, I don't know if it's a dilemma, but trade-off that needs to be broken with either being resilient. We need to be resilient because we've found that we're very vulnerable. But at the same time, we need to be competitive. So what the United States has done with this initiative, they've put us in a situation of saying, what can we do to be competitive? Because furthermore, there's a difference, a key difference between EU and the United States. We're very dependent of the external sector. In the case of Spain, well, imagine our GDP depends 40% on the external trade, far more than most European countries, and far less than in the United States. So beyond this issue of multilateralism and what we do and how they have an impact on others, we're very aware of this. So that's the situation we're in, where we, other than what others might be doing, we have to decide how we need to be competitive given the increased competitiveness abroad. It puts us in a situation of asking ourselves, how do we want European policies reinforce competitiveness of European companies? We're talking about industrial policy, but our own policy in the EU. We're talking about trade policy. EU has a trade policy, and it's not just anecdotal worldwide. I see it as a competitive advantage. The fact that we have a strong trade policy that's committed and efficient, and we have to see how this competition policy can increase competitiveness. So that's the current discussion. It has to be our own debate. It has to be the companies and the governments of the European Union discussing this. And right now, the question that you've asked is, what would we like? Where do we think we need to go in this discussion? Very clear, we shouldn't be defensive. We need to have our own roadmap. We talk a lot about, not just European companies through Business Europe, but also we talk to companies of the companies in the OECD, and this is an ongoing debate. So what can we do regarding IRA? We don't want, number one, we don't want to get into a subsidy war, because every time you say the word war, it's very sensitive. I'm talking about subsidy war. We don't want a war of subsidies between the EU and USA. We don't think that's efficient. Emily has very well described all the requirements for local content. It's not that we don't want it. It's that we can't afford being so strict with local contents because we're so dependent on countries abroad and we're more vulnerable in Europe. We need to look for state subsidies, but not to increase them, which of course we should, but we want to make sure that those state subsidies can benefit companies, large, small, and medium companies. We have a whole debate on that at the moment about state grants and subsidies. Everything related to permits, to speed up permits for companies. In many cases, they're not standardized. That's also a pending task that needs to be approved in the EU. The regulatory overload, when we differentiate USA and the EU, we always talk about regulatory overload in the EU. And I think in this case, Business Europe is doing a very sound campaign with excellent messages, regulatory burden, which will not just have a positive impact on energy industries themselves, but also those belonging to the whole supply chain, not just focusing on unburdening energy companies, although, of course, also unburdening them. And then there's another key aspect, which is the trade policy. Trade policy is a key element in the current context to supply raw materials that are necessary for energy transition, to supply and look for sources of raw materials, but also to make sure that those raw materials are coming from those countries and they're included in supply chains that are resilient and sustainable, because that's what our trade partners are asking for. And that's where we have Global Gateway, another very interesting initiative where there are going to be investment for those countries where we're with whom we're negotiating FTAs so that those raw materials we're importing from those countries will also generate value in their own countries. And I think here the trade policy is essential and it's a competitive advantage. I think this and many other elements are the ones that companies want to have on the table so that we could discuss this with government so that we don't end up with regulations that have already been completed but not previously discussed with companies. And I loved the image of Frank Gehry's architecture. It's not as sinuous, it's not as clean. I think we still have some sharp edges and things sticking out. But another image that comes to mind very often when we talk about multilateralism, of course, the parameters have changed, but we need to continue defending them. Why? Because that makes situation more predictable and more secure when it comes to making decisions, and that's essential. And right now, multilateralism is seen as a dance floor. We talk about this in a lot of international fora where suddenly the music has stopped in the dance floor. Everyone is standing still and everyone's looking to see who they should dance with again. And this is wonderful. This thing of friends, allies. I don't know if you're my friend, my ally. You're probably both. I don't know. What we really definitely need to look for is who we want to dance with, because we're dancing in the same way. There's an understanding. And for that, we need a music that everyone in the room is sharing, because if everyone's dancing at a different pace, we're all going to trip and fall. Well, I will definitely be a friend and ally, but I'm not a very good dancing partner. No, you have to learn how to dance. Yes, in literal and figurative terms as well, of course. I have a lot of questions that have come through the chat. I'm going to try to group them together. And also, the first question is quite complicated. I'm going to ask Federico, who's a good friend. He's going to excuse me. Would it be possible for the EU to mediate or help China and the United States to come closer together. Maybe we could also engage Emily to say, what is the EU talking about? They want to mediate between China and the United States. And they say, well, to what extent is EU interested in this relationship in the Pacific? So this is a more political question. Federico, go ahead. I think structurally, the only thing that everyone agrees on in the United States is that the threat and rivalry with China is the key element. And I think after that, it's nothing that anyone does from outside is going to change them or move them. That said, it's true that right now in the United States and the administration, there are people who are harsher with China, and there are people who are less harsh. There are people who think that the invasion of Taiwan is imminent, especially in the DOD, and other people who think that it's not the case and it's perfectly avoidable. More people in the Foreign Office and so on. And what the EU could do is look for topics where American elites think that they're going to have to agree with China no matter what. So basically today, in medium long term, are climate change topics. Medium term, the problem of debt and default of many emerging countries, with the hike of interest rates worldwide, is getting more difficult. And there, China has a very important position because they're the main creditor of many of these countries outside the Paris Club. And then the issues of a softer governance about global health, some elements of cooperation, and so on. Perhaps the EU has a role to play, but the harsher part, I think we have very little to do. But even so, I think Europe has to have a different position vis-a-vis China than the United States, because what we see very clearly with the Biden administration is that there's very strong pressure to align the EU with the United States. And then depending on what happens in the U.S. elections in next year, this could change. And in Europe, as is often the case, we don't have a clear plan B about what would happen if there's a Republican who decides that forget about supporting Ukraine, they only care about China, and then Europe will be an ally, but less important. And this could happen 2 years from now.
Any of you can intervene, and you can also answer these questions. But I have another one here. I think this can be addressed to our friends from the Commission or to the business sector. And it's the following. When we compare initiatives of the IRA with Net Zero Industry Act, or compared to the Industrial Plan Green Deal, what are the most salient elements? What are the main differences? Carlos, why don't you tell us, in your view, what elements you would like to point out? In our plans, we try to be consistent, and we have tax credits in the IRA, yes, but I would say that they're useful. And if you look at the plans inside, you can see the different strategies that European countries are implementing. You can compare Spain to Italy. If you look at the Chapter 9 of the Spanish Recovery Plan, there is a strategy on renewable hydrogen with financing to SMEs, with the creation of pioneer projects, establishing other projects, and the final pie is an amount of megawatts installed. That's a bottom-up strategy. It can be done in 2021, but it was from 2021 until 2026. And in the case of the Italian plan, on the contrary, what we have is the decision to finance Enel to create a solar panel factory in Sicily. Actually, it was already opened. And that is a much more bottom-down approach. I don't know what strategy can be better on the midterm. In the case of technological companies like the telephone companies, they always wanted to be where there is more value, which is content. For example, Telefónica bought the Gran Hermano company. They've had frictions with Google because they are the ones that provide the infrastructure. But nevertheless, Apple, it has a market cap of 2 billion. And on the other hand, in green technologies, we don't know very well whether a greater concentration around utilities can be the way forward. Is this bottom-up approach of Spain is the way to proceed? Or if we would have to look at the Iberdrolas and Endesas, in this case, Enel, so that they make the main investments. Because going back to what we were saying about extreme intervention measures there, the aim has been to limit margins. So that consumers it was very clear that margins were sky high, and who was benefiting from that? Utilities. And most of the measures were to cut back on those increases in their margins. But you can use Article 132 of the treaty. Well, you can use that for some time, but you cannot implement that on the long term. If we have to do it, we do it, but we don't feel comfortable about it. But those margins that will continue to be very high. And in that regard, we give a signal to the market to continue to invest in renewables, because in the short term, gas will continue to be a technology that will set the price. So in the Commission, we are reforming the electricity market. I know you know this, Gonzalo. There, we've received very interesting contributions from Spain. And the aim, well, there are many goals, of course, but the main one is for gas prices not to be linked to electricity prices. And meanwhile, utilities have huge margins, and they can lead this process of readjustment. In Spain, we have examples of very relevant utilities that had extraordinary results because they saw that. And the process, I think, is unstoppable. So there's also going to be a segmentation, I think. As Spain decided for the bottom-up approach, Italy bottomed up. So we have to be technologically neutral, and we work on policies for SMEs, but we're expectant. It's too soon to say this is going to be the way it happens. Utilities are very much focused on green transition. I wanted to make a more macro structural remark. You asked about differences between American legislation and our plans here in Europe. Often, I don't know if everyone agrees, probably not, but often we think that when the American administration adopts a legislation, the implementation is easier. Governance is easier. There's a lot of political debate prior to it, but then there's a political will and things happen faster. Whilst we notice that in Europe, reaching an agreement and developing the legislation after that is very cumbersome, very difficult. And all the plans we have and the reaction that is to what the US is doing, well, in the European market, there might be a certain risk. Federico mentioned the internal market, not only because we're celebrating our anniversary this year. We're celebrating this year also the 50th anniversary of Spain-China diplomatic relations, by the way. So we think that we need to preserve this jewel. And we hear things in other countries or in Spain about the European Union, about how governments want to support their companies. And that is a risk that does not exist on the other side of the Atlantic. And we have to face this together so that that won't happen. Thank you, Marta. I have another question, which I think is for Claudia. Because Claudia, you talked about the National Energy and Climate Integrated Plans, that there are important elements of competitiveness to consider and develop. And somebody asked, could you elaborate more on those competitiveness elements of those plans, climate and energy plans? Thank you. Yes, as I mentioned earlier, with the governance of the energy union, one of the main things that must be reflected in these national plans, which are going to be updated in view of the energy transition goals of 2030 and 2040, because things have changed drastically. All those measures that the member states identify as useful to, one, develop competencies of their labor market, two, attract talent, because the population is not growing in the European Union, and the member states have a labor force, but not enough to meet demand. So we need to attract trained personnel from third countries, and also to, in renewable energies, try to manufacture these energies in Europe, because we don't want to go from depending from Russian gas to depend on others, on China production, when, for example, photovoltaic energy. We don't want to go from depending on Russia to depending on China. And then we have the circular economy. We don't have those critical raw materials that can be found in Latin America, like lithium in Chile or in the US, rare earth in China. We depend on others. And the material that once its useful life is over, what technology can we use so that this material can be used still in the EU? How do we give it a second life? These are things that the member states must identify in their integrated national plans, because these are measures that will not only contribute to security of supply in the supply chains, but also will increase the competitiveness of our industry, will drive forward innovation. So these are measures that can be integrated into these plans. But in the Net Zero Industry Act and Article 30 on reporting, it says that monitoring tools must be used of the situation of the industry competitiveness in the member states. And every 2 years, the member states have the obligation of reporting to the EU on the implementation of those plans. So the element of competitiveness is reflected. When the Net Zero Industry Act is approved, it is a regulation, and it will be legally binding. Therefore, so there will be a responsibility from the member states of reporting to the EU and to the European Commission on how all these measures that are identified in the national plans are being implemented. Those would be the elements. It is something that in the European Commission and in my team, we are cooperating. We are in constant dialogue with the member states and the public administrations to see what the current situation is, because it has changed a lot vis-a-vis the plans that were delivered in 2020 and how we can tackle these new challenges. And here, and this goes for Martha, maybe you can illustrate this, because last week in the Brussels Economic Forum, it is something that was mentioned a lot. Calvino, the minister, mentioned it also. And it's been mentioned very often. And that is the need of cooperation between the public administrations and the private sector. In other words, in order to increase competitiveness, and in order for these challenges are reflected in strategic planning of the member states, we need to have this constant dialogue. And perhaps it's more difficult to achieve than what we expected originally. So there you go. I sent you this question, Marta, or I asked for your remarks on this. Thank you, Claudia. Well, if I may, I'm going to add to your question another question from the audience, also for Martha. Or maybe, Carlos, you can also intervene. Let me read it. Is the EU starting to be aware that agility and aid is a key aspect for a transition to be done at the necessary pace? You can combine both if you want. Carlos, you can also mention something. And at the end, we'll give a minute to Federico to tell us what is going to happen in the future. Yes, very briefly. That permanent debate you mentioned, I don't know in what the terms that intervention happened. It was in Brussels in the Economic Forum. But that can only be achieved with a private dialogue between governments and the private sector. And before things have been completed, and everything you mentioned, when we talk about resilience of the supply chains, I have participated in the last few months, or actually 2 or 3 years, in many international meetings where governments told companies what we needed to do for our supply chains to be more resilient. They talked about reshoring and all these measures that we've heard about, and companies, Spanish, Australian, etc., raised their hand and said, do you know how many suppliers we have in the world? Do you know in how many countries I'm working and operating? You know that I don't have a negotiating position as a company in many countries. It is my suppliers in those countries who have the power to negotiate. Do you know, are you aware of these things? So yes, of course, permanent dialogue. And on the second question, I think that the European Union, if it hadn't realized, now it does have the chance. I think they have realized that we need to speed things up, to answer your question. Recently, we've had studies on who is benefiting more from state aid. And I think it gives us very interesting information on the what we need to do so that this will benefit the business fabric of all countries. I don't want us to be reactive, but it is true that there are some measures that have been sold, like that the U.S. is going to turn into the super producer of clean energy in the world. Excuse me, weren't we going to do that? So it leaves us in a situation where we're in very good conditions, that under the Spanish presidency of the EU measures are adopted that can help us out. Carlos, in just 1 minute, well, it's always a pendulum between flexibility and problems. If we look at France and Germany, they gain 80% of state aid. If we make that more flexible, a competition policy is for the smaller ones to be in the same conditions as others. In terms of recovery plans, we have established more controls because they have been aids in some countries, in Eastern countries that have financed the political careers of their ministers. And I'm not going to mention any names because I don't want to get into trouble, but that's why this criteria was established, to know who the ultimate beneficiary is. That has introduced rigidities. We try to turn things around, and giving the money directly to the account of the Spanish Treasury, of the Bank of Spain, at the ECB. That is where we transfer the money, and then the Spanish state and the different member states transfer those funds. That's different to cohesion funds, where they're paid ex post based on bills and invoices. But in these other funds, it's based on whether you fulfilled your goals. Spain has received a lot of money between recovery and cohesion funds. In 6 years, a lot of money, like 35 billion per year. In companies, not many companies have a capex of 35 billion a year systematically for 5 years. I don't know if there are any, but Martha will know better. But when you get such a huge amount of funds, that stresses the system. And I think Spain is doing relatively well. There were the first and second payments already. We'll see how third, fourth, and fifth payments go. But that's where we are. 1 minute for Federico. What about the long term, geopolitically speaking? Yes, I would say that recovery plans are being implemented and we're reaching cruising speed. Public investment, we're gaining a good speed. And we can tell that. What about the reform of tax rules? I'm not going to go into that now, but it is important to be taken into account. And we need to adapt to this new reality where it is worthwhile for those of us who have this liberal vision, we should readjust some paradigms so that we won't be caught by surprise. Because there's going to be more intervention, more national security linked to national security linked to economic security, etc. Thank you. And now let's hear from the president, from our chair, so that he can bid us farewell. Yes, thank you. First of all, thank you, Gonzalo, Marta, Federico, Carlos, and Claudia. We talked about industrial policy, climate policy. Well, not surprisingly, of course, because this is a very complex issue. And thank you so much again. And let me give the floor to Rafael Villaseco, who is the chairman of the Naturgy Foundation. Thank you. I'd like to thank all the speakers and our moderator for this excellent meeting. It's a very interesting subject that has attracted many people. We have a lot of people following us through streaming. And I think it's because it's a very exciting and interesting subject. And we've had a debate on very interesting things. All of these things affect the world of energy. This is nothing new. Energy has been related to many geostrategic elements. But now it has gained cruising speed. And I think we should be very glad about this, although, of course, we have the war on the Ukraine. But we've heard a lot of interesting things here, like geostrategic relations, the lack of a good industrial policy, difficulties to face climate change, et cetera, et cetera. All these things are not new. We've been talking about this for more than a decade now. And it is very exciting and to see that the European Union has decided to design plans that will allow us to have a longer term vision. And that is new. And we should all be very hopeful about this because it is our way to face the very serious problems that we have in the world of energy. Because we have to be optimistic about the solutions that are being looked for, but we must be aware of the complex situation we are facing in the world. This is why these meetings are so important. I have to thank the Elcano Institute for their kindness and for allowing us to organize this meeting. And we want to continue to work on these things because the world of energy is very much linked to geostrategy, and we will continue to be involved. Thank you to all the speakers who have participated in this event. I invite you to continue to follow our meetings, which always deal with very interesting subjects. Thank you.